We are about to begin, and I'm extremely thankful to each and every one of you who come here at short notice. Let me request Dr. Vipul Mudgal. He's the director of Common Cause, and he is the master of ceremonies today's function. Vipul, over to you. The tea is over, but there's more tea coming, and the books are available for sale at the back.
Thank you, Paranjoy. It's a privilege to welcome you all. Let me first invite the speakers to come to the dais. Mr. Arun Shori, Mr. Prashant Bhushan, Mr. Kamal Kant Jaswal, Ms. Karuna Nandi, Mr. Dinesh Divedi, and Mr. Hathor Singhbal. It's a privilege to welcome you all. The book is very appropriately called Loose Pages, Court Cases That Could Have Taken India But Did Not End Up Doing So. The book examines two sets of documents, Birla Sahara Papers and Kalikopol's Suicide Note. And you need to do a lot of reading between the lines, and that is where the authors really help you put it all together. They join the dots and help you see how this has become a rough guide to Indian democracy. I have also the privilege of reading the manuscripts of the book, and I can tell you that it's a page turner. Once you start it, it's absolutely unputdownable. It's like, you know, truth being stranger than fiction. This is, you will see all the big shots, all the big institutions, how they work in tandem and how democracy is undermined. My own takeaway is in two parts, and I'll not take very long. I'll just say two things in this. One is that there is a monster in front of us. In the midst of all of us, there is a monster which eats money. And it is called the election. It is eating money today. It is all around us. Between early October and early December, it will eat about 10,000 crores. Which is about 200 crores a day, 150, 200, give or take 30, 40 crores here or there. It is eating about 6 to 10 crores every hour. That money has to be procured from somewhere. All parties have to get that money. Somebody has to do the deal. Somebody has to spend the money. Somebody has to return that money. Now, why are we surprised when money comes tumbling out of cupboards, when there is an IT raid, or there is a election commission raid, or there is a seizure of any type? What kind of evidence are we looking for? There have been diaries in the past, Jain Hawala diaries, which were actually not diaries. They were a set of papers, I'm told, by a very senior CBI officer who happens to be here, that Jain Hawala diaries were not diaries at all. They were like balance sheets. They were, everything was matching. There was expenditure. And there was the earning and all the money, which, how much went to which side, was all shown. But if you see the Sahara Birla papers, it will take your breath away. This is like pakka, absolutely pakka accounting work. You know, all the name of the person who delivered the money, the phone number of the person, the designation of the person, everything is given. The time, and what is not given perhaps, which could have been accepted as evidence, is that there is no receipt. Nobody has said that 89 crores of black money received with hands in 5 installments. So perhaps the authorities are looking for that. We will have some question answers in the end. But anyway, we should not be surprised that door number key entries are recovered. And the second point, that the brief point that I want to make, my takeaway from the book, from the manuscript that I read, is that the money can win you elections, but you need something else. To stay in the business, you need to stop the watchdogs from doing their work. You need to stop whichever watchdog, it could be CBI, it could be CBC, it could be CAG of India, it could be the court. You have to make sure that they do not do their job, so that this business of taking money and giving money continues. So with this, this is almost like a provocation to my speakers. I'll invite one by one, and probably you have, there's no timekeeping, but yes, roughly about 10-12 minutes. We start with Hartosh Singh Bal. Hartosh was the first person who actually put these papers in public domain as the political editor of Caravan magazine. Hartosh Singh Bal, it's actually no point introducing Mr. Arun Shori in Press Club of India. I mean, it's like, but I'm told I'm given this responsibility of introducing people in probably one line. I would say Hartosh Singh Bal, investigative journalist, political editor, award-winning author. He's written a book of fiction which can be described as, like, you have science fiction, philosophy and mathematics fiction. So this is what he does in his free time whenever he gets it. Mr. Dinesh Dwivedi, one of India's most respected senior lawyers of the Supreme Court of India, an expert on constitutional matters, and takes up a large number of public interest petitions. One of our petitions against criminalization of politics was taken up by him. Karuna Nandi, a human rights lawyer with specialization on women's safety, constitutional matters, also an activist and a winner of many, many awards. Activist. So she's not an activist. Okay. She's a legal scholar. Okay. Mr. Kamalkant Jaswal, a very respected former IS officer of UP cadre, has been IT secretary, member secretary of NCEUS, popularly known as Arjun Sengupta Commission on Unorganized Sector, and he's also the president of civil society organization Common Cause. Mr. Prashant Bhushan, public interest lawyer, legal activist, sir, after activist act, works on judicial accountability and reform. Mr. Arun Shori, economist, journalist, author, politician who's becoming unfit for politics. I hope you stay in politics, sir. So over to Hartosh Singh Bal.
Good evening, and I'll really just set the stage for the speakers to follow. I think this story in the book Paranjoy and its co-author have written, I think, is illustrative of our times. I was talking to a few people right before the function started, and they did ask me, in what way does this period, this time frame, this Modi administration, 2014, how does it differ from what has preceded? And I think the simple answer is that we have lost all sense of shame. And what does that mean? Bigotry is respectable today. You are allowed to voice opinion in public that you would be ashamed of in private 5 or 7 years ago. You may have believed the same thing, you would have never voiced it. That same sense of shame is today apparent in every aspect of public life. And what this book documents is that same sense of shame has come to areas such as corruption, governance, law, investigation. It pervades every aspect of this government. I think it's now some years since Paranjoy came to us. As usual, when Paranjoy comes to office, we know that we are in it for the long haul. I've got an interesting story for you. And we said, sure, will you carry it? We said, we'll sit down with it, we'll see what we have to do with it. And Vinod and I and Anant are editors at Caravan. We looked at what are the Sahara Birla papers. As Vipul has said, it was a clear set of entries. Not indications, it was entries about politicians, naming the people who had gone, met them where, on which date, documenting the amount that had been paid. It included a list of politicians across political parties, Shivraj Chauhan in Madhya Pradesh, Sheila Dikshit in Delhi. But most importantly, Narendra Modi as Chief Minister of Gujarat. And there are separate entries by a man named Jaiswal who has made those payments. Clearly, these were not simple fabrications of a computer. These were detailed entries which would allow examination and investigation if they were acted on. So when we finally published the story, it was published after asking everybody involved in the story to respond. We published excerpts from the diary. As is evident now, and as the book mentions, that the income tax officer Anjali Pandey, who had made these seizures of the diary, who refused to confirm or deny it, her signatures matched the signatures which were on these papers in terms of the collection of these papers during an income tax raid. As you go through the book, and I think there are enough lawyers here who will detail out what happened in court, but I will just point to a few indicators that when this matter, like the Calico Pool, which was a suicide note of a former chief minister naming the sons and relatives of two people who went on then to become chief justices of India. Justice Kehar's son as having received money, and Arun Mishra's relative. Again, these are stories we followed up in Caravan. We actually contacted Justice Kehar's son, who after a 5-minute conversation fishing around for information or evidence refused to comment one way or the other about the allegations against him. My point is that when these cases went up in the Supreme Court, one, Justice Kehar had no business actually sitting on judgment in this case. But as we have seen later in the Arun Mishra case, there has been an unfortunate tendency, I think, which became most visible in the Lohia case, that a demand for an investigation is preempted by the courts by saying that they have looked at the material evidence and decided it does not require an evidence. But while doing so, they don't allow the full scope of material that is available to be actually subject to scrutiny in making that decision. In some ways, the very decision they are asked to make is a decision that is prejudged by the court and used to dismiss a very valid case for investigation. And this was as true in the Sahara Billa diaries again, which I think again the lawyers who follow will make a clear case for that. It is also true that the number of public officials who intersect with the story are again pointers to the same sense of shame that is totally missing. It again involves the same characters, the same stories. The person involved with the income tax department, late, not the income tax department, but today who is CVC, job is a perfect example of what goes wrong. Mr. Chaudhary was a constant visitor to Ranjit Sinha's house. These two investigation agencies were actually looking at each other's role, and Mr. Sinha and Mr. Chaudhary both ended up giving clean chits to each other. Not only that, Mr. Chaudhary's visits were logged in the Ranjit Sinha diaries. Unfortunately, when the Supreme Court actually allowed the examination of these diaries, it limited the mandate of the Sharma Committee to a single point, which is the coal scam. It makes for depressing reading. Ambani officials, senior Ambani men, including a man very well known to most journalists in Delhi who are investigating anything, Tony Jesudasan, were constant visitors to Ranjit Sinha's house. At the same time, Mr. Chaudhary was visiting. The number of important investigations that were going on at that point of time started from the 2G, involved the coal scam, involved the Radia tapes. The people meeting Ranjit Sinha at his residence were party in each of these cases, but the only aspect so far that has been examined, despite people like Prashant Bhushan pushing for it, is the involvement of those named in the coal scam. Clearly, as this book points out, not only is it a missed opportunity, an opportunity that should have gone to the core of the rot that leads to the very top of this government, it is also a symptom of where we are today, that we are in public life where any dereliction, any violation, any misdemeanor by an official is not enough to stop them from holding the highest posts. Not only that, they can use these highest posts to derail justice and the benefits of this go directly to the person in power today, Narendra Modi and this government. And I think you'll hear more of these details from the people who called us.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen and friends. I am certainly new to this assembly, and the assembly is a little daunting. I have been asked by Mr. Paranjoy to come on this occasion, and I felt I was on this pit. But nevertheless, I came because of our friendship, and this is not very old, it's about 5-6 months old. But we evolved our friendship, because when I met him a couple of occasions, I found that he's a man who is quite frank, forthright, and depth of analysis. He's painstaking in his efforts. So that attracted me towards him. And since then we carried on. Then he asked me to look into the book, make suggestions if possible. I did go through the book. There were certain differences between us, but then that's fair enough. And I'm sure he must have taken them into consideration. Now, when I look at the title of the book, that is where my difference is with him, serious difference. Loose Pages. Now, when I read the book before it was finalized, I found it was quite incisive. Calling spade a spade, it was forthright, and then I felt it certainly deserved a better heading than Loose Pages. As we say in Hindi, sab ka mazmoon jo hai wo cover ko dekh ke samajh mein nahi aata. That's fair enough. But anyway, when I went through the book, I found that it was a painstaking effort with rationalization of the best level. At least I couldn't have done it. And I do therefore compliment him for the effort he has put in. And I'm not competent enough to make any assessment or judgment on whatever he has written. It's certainly worth reading. There's no doubt about it. There is another difference which I had. The important topic of missed opportunity. Of course, it referred to Supreme Court missing opportunities. But then I think the correct way of looking at it is, Supreme Court doesn't function on opportunity. It has to perform an obligation to uphold the Constitution and the law, and to uphold it in accordance with the Constitution and the law. So therefore, if Supreme Court fails to do that, then it is certainly in gross error and is failing to discharge its constitutional obligation. It's not a case of missed opportunity. Which is quite mild way of saying that Supreme Court was committing an error, serious error. Now the serious error which Paranjoy has of course referred to is that Supreme Court, while assessing the Birla Sahara diaries and other papers, loose papers,
applied totally wrong principle of law in avoiding investigation into the matter, because that was not the stage of evidence. The evidence comes only post investigation commencing, and then some document being filed in the court of law along with the evidence to charge a person. But there are stages when the allegation is made, the court's jurisdiction is very limited. It can at best say that the allegations on the face reading do contain the necessary ingredients of the offense alleged. If they do, then the court has to proceed with the investigation. Now, let me show it another way. Supposing tomorrow we go to lodge an FIR in the police station, and the investigating officer over there, or the thana in charge over there, tells us that where is the evidence in relation to this allegation. Now, the person who goes to lodge an FIR just informs. If he is further to supply the investigating officer the evidence as per the Evidence Act, then what is the use of investigation? It is the obligation of the investigator to find out. And there are so many investigations in the horizon that I don't know why. The critical question to realize and ask is, assuming Supreme Court failed, which it did, there's no doubt about it. It applied wrong judgment to Supreme Court. It was, according to me, not applicable. But then, what still remains to be asked, and it bothers me, that there are so many investigating agencies under the sun. Why none of them is taking up these investigations, which I am more than confident the allegations are strong enough to at least call for investigation into the matter, collect evidence, and if after investigation you don't find relevant material, then you can give up the investigation. But that is not being done. That is the critical part, which is sad and which is destroying the system. Now, coming back to the book points out all these things in a better way than I have been able to, I'm sure. And I must compliment Mr. Paranjoy for this effort, thorough effort. And I hope we get to see many more such books coming out and many more such occasions where I don't know whether I'll get an opportunity to meet you people again or not, but I certainly hope I may. Thank you, Paranjoy. Thank you, everyone.
So this particular book this book is based on a series of documents which went to the Supreme Court, as has been mentioned. And when the Supreme Court did not find it fit to start an investigation into the Sahara Birla paper, it termed it as loose sheets of paper. And to do this, it relied on an act which is more than 1.5 century old, and 1872, and a part of these papers were thrown out because they were not in a bound form, and they could be loosely detached at any moment. So what are these papers? These papers are 4 major volumes of an investigative report prepared by the Income Tax Department, allegedly, and a verdict pronounced by the Income Tax Settlement Commission. Apart from this, it also includes a 60-page suicide note typed and signed by a former chief minister of this country, Mr. Kaliko Pul, former chief minister of Arunachal Pradesh. And all of this evidence at various points reaches the Supreme Court, but the Supreme Court does not find it fit to start an investigation on these papers. So I think a lot has been written about the nexus between politicians, bureaucrats, and the biggest corporations in our country. But what the case of the Sahara Birla papers and Thaliko Pool's suicide note show is that the Supreme Court itself, in the higher judiciary of our country, has been functioning in a manner over the years which ultimately led to the famous press briefing called at the beginning of this year by the four senior-most judges of the Supreme Court after the CJI. So this book follows the patterns of what's been going on in the Supreme Court at the higher levels of the bureaucracy, the legislature, the executive, and puts everything together to show actually how some of the most important decisions in our country regarding the allocation of natural resources, scarce natural resources, have been made over the years. So I hope you guys enjoy reading this book, and contemplate deeply. I think right now we're in a situation where a serving director of the CBI terms it the Center for Bogus Investigation and calls the Enforcement Directorate the Extortion Directorate. Never before in our country has something like this happened. And the question is out there right now. Like, can these institutions be reformed? Like, can the premier investigative agencies actually be made more autonomous while functioning under the legislature? So, please read this book and come to your own conclusions about it.
I just wanted to emphasize that what Sourya and I was able to do is, a lot of us keep talking about the nexus between business and politics. But the role that is played by the judiciary, especially the higher judiciary, often doesn't come under the scanner. Most writers, most journalists are scared of committing what is called contempt of court. And today we find that there are large influential individuals, including representatives of corporate groups, who often, in my opinion, misuse the law to harass and intimidate all those who put out anything in the public domain which is critical of our netas, our babus. Yesterday at an interview, Sourya and I, we were asked, the Supreme Court said these documents are, well, for all practical purposes, useless. How do you know they're authentic? How do you know they're genuine? All I can say is that we tried our best to ask the persons concerned, are these documents genuine? Are these documents authentic? Are these documents credible? We send questionnaires, we send detailed questionnaires which have been reproduced as annexures in the book to important people, very, very important people, some of the most important and most influential persons in this country. None of them got back to us. None of them said that these documents are, whatever, forged or inaccurate or not authentic. As journalists, as writers, we try and do our level best. Maybe we don't have the answers to all the questions, but I think it's very important to raise the questions that matter. I want to thank all of the people here on the panel, Vipul Mudgal and Kamalji in particular, as with Common Cause. Common Cause has been in the forefront. I am indebted to them. I happen to be on the Governing Council of Common Cause. Dinesh Divediji, Karuna Nandi, Prashant Bhushan, Kamal Hartosh Bal, and of course Mr. Arun Shuri for agreeing to speak here at such short notice. One of our colleagues, I don't spot her, Shinjani, she helped us a lot with the legal read. After we wrote the manuscript, we ran it through a number of lawyers. We wanted to be very, very sure that every single detail was accurate. The legalese and the bureaucraties. And I must give Sourya credit that we were able to sort of go through huge volumes of data which were written in very, very boring prose, in bureaucratic language, in legal language, and tried our level best to tell you a story which will hopefully engage you. I want to also thank my wife and daughter, Jaya and Trivini, they are here. Our son couldn't be here. Sourya's parents are here. They come from Mumbai and Kolkata to be here on the occasion. So that's all. Thank you so much once again.
We are now invite Prashant Bhushan, who gave a very, very spirited defense and took up this case to the Supreme Court. Please come and speak.
Good evening, everybody. The book is very appropriately titled, Loose Papers, Court Cases That Have
that could have shaken India. Indeed, the history of this country could have been and possibly would have been very different had the Birla Sahara papers been subjected to a proper investigation. So what was found in the Birla and Sahara papers? Income tax raided Birla, CBI, or maybe the other way around, CBI raided one, income tax raided the other. I think income tax raided Birla, CBI raided Sahara. But after the raid by the CBI, instead of embarking on an investigation on the basis of what it had recovered, it just handed over the papers to the income tax. So let's quickly see what were the kind of documents that were recovered in these raids. So in the Birla case, there were a large number of emails written by the group president to other senior officers, to various other people. There were notebooks maintained which seemed to be notebooks of some kind of accounts. There were other, what Supreme Court calls, loose papers which mentioned payments to various people in the ministry, officials in the Ministry of Environment, to people in the Directorate of Revenue Intelligence, and various other officials. And in particular, 25 lakhs in cash was recovered from the 25 crores of cash was recovered from an almirah in one of the premises. And not only that, the income tax examined all these people and prepared a four-volume appraisal report. It was just six. The four volumes are about 1500 pages in all. And in that appraisal report, they said that we asked the custodian of this almirah from where the cash was recovered as to how did this cash get here, who does it belong to, and what is it used for. And that person gave answer that yes, this cash is comes from various angadiyas, that is these kind of hawala dealers who deliver this cash in amount from time to time, few crores, 50 lakhs, 1 crore, etc. at a time. And thereafter it is used for delivering to various government officials on the directions of our group president. Thereafter the income tax went to some of these angadiyas who confirmed that yes, I have been paying and I recently paid this money which was recorded in that diary. The notes that were recovered regarding payments to the Ministry of Environment tallied very clearly with the clearances, the dates tallied very, very precisely with the dates on which environmental clearances were given to the Birla group of companies by the Ministry of Environment. So, the appraisal report said that we have examined these documents that we have recovered and our investigation shows that these documents represent the correct state of affairs. That these payments have indeed been made, that this cash has indeed been recovered, etc. Yet, in the face of this 1500 page appraisal report of the Income Tax Department itself, which confirmed not only the recovery of these documents, but which confirmed the contents of these documents, even then the Supreme Court said that these are loose papers on the basis of which no investigation can be ordered. And what happened in the Sahara case? In the Sahara case, one critical document which was recovered was a spreadsheet recovered from the computer of one of the officials of Sahara. That spreadsheet contained on the one side details of cash received, 137 crores of cash received over a period of less than a year from different sources. The sources are mentioned, the dates are mentioned, the amounts are mentioned. And most of the sources are mentioned as Marcom. Marcom means the marketing communication company of Sahara. On the other side of the spreadsheet contains details of how this 137 crore cash which was received was spent. And it mentions 9 entries mentioning 9 payments of 5 crores each, 7 payments of 5 crores each, 2 payments of 2.5 crores each to Gujarat Chief Minister or Mr. Modi. Either referred to as Gujarat Chief Minister or Modi. The date of payment, the place of payment, in every case the payment is mentioned as having been paid in Ahmedabad. Dates are mentioned, place is mentioned. The person who took the money is mentioned and the person in whose hand the cash is delivered is mentioned. In each case, it is delivered in the hands of Mr. Modi in Ahmedabad. And the person who takes the cash is mentioned as Kanhaiya Jaiswal, who is an officer of Sahara. Then there are many other entries containing 2 entries to Mr. Shivraj Chauhan, totaling 10 crores. 1 entry to Mr. Chhattisgarh Chief Minister Raman Singh, 4 crores. 1 entry to Sheila Dixit, 1 crore. And various other entries, total 135 crore, having been paid on different dates at different places by different people in the hands of different persons. Such a detailed account. And we didn't get a copy of the income tax appraisal report, but what we did get was an order of the settlement commission, because once we filed this case, Birla quickly moved the settlement income tax settlement commission to settle the case, and that settlement commission with great alacrity transferred out one official, brought in somebody else, quickly had a hearing, and within a month this case was settled and the papers were quickly handed back to this company. But in the order of that settlement commission they say, income tax department said that they have cross-checked the receipts of cash mentioned from this company Marcom, which is a marketing communication company, and found that it tallies with the ledger entries of that Marcom, that on the same date where cash is received is mentioned in this spreadsheet, cash having been withdrawn from Marcom is mentioned same amount, same date, and they said that this tallies, and therefore that would have confirmed the authenticity of the entries. So they not only confirmed the recovery of the spreadsheet in the rate, they also confirmed the amount mentioned in the spreadsheet as being the true state of affairs. And yet the Supreme Court says that these are all loose papers, not admissible evidence, no investigation can be ordered on the basis of this. Even in the Birla case, most of the payments are shown to have been made to Congress politicians. But one entry in the computer of the group president Shubhendu Amitabh says 25 crores to Gujarat CM. And in bracket it says 12 paid, 13 to be paid, something like that. Now, normally you would have expected this government, that is the Modi government, to have jumped to an investigation showing payments to Mr. Modi. Had been mentioning that in this Ministry of Environment there was the Jayanti tax. Now, many of the payments apparently were made to Jayanti Natarajan in that. But because of this one entry of 25 crores to Narendra Modi, to Mr. Modi, nothing was allowed to be investigated. The whole case was stonewalled, and the gentleman in the income tax department who was in charge of the recovery of all these documents who was heading the investigation department of income tax. He just buried the papers, did not send them to the CBI, even after this detailed appraisal report prepared by his own department. He doesn't send it to the CBI for investigation, that here are clear bribes shown to have been paid, but he doesn't send it. As soon as we started getting this information that these documents were recovered and that they have been buried by this gentleman, Mr. K.V. Chaudhary, who today happens to be the Chief Vigilance Commissioner. At that very time, I started tweeting about it, that I am hearing that this gentleman is likely to be appointed as the CVC, and this is what I have come to know, that he was in charge of burying these papers which were recovered. Mr. Jethmalani wrote a detailed letter to the Prime Minister. I wrote a letter, by which time I had also found out that this gentleman was involved in the stock guru scam, where the income tax people had been bribed in one investigation that they were doing in this, or rather the CBI had been investigating the stock guru scam, in which income tax officials were bribed by this company called Stock Guru, which was in the stock market, and that entries regarding his going to meet Mr. Ranjit Sinha must have had to do with this particular investigation, where officials directly working under him were being investigated in that Stock Guru scam by the CBI. So this gentleman, who buries all this information on the paper, he is appointed the Chief Vigilance Commissioner. We also challenge his appointment, that same judge. Ultimately, you see, this Birla Sahara application, as well as the challenge to the appointment of the CVC, all came to be dismissed by that one particular judge called Justice Arun Mishra. No, not yet. And this Justice Arun Mishra, we found, was very close to the BJP, so much so that in the wedding that he celebrated of his nephew at his residence, he had invited all the top BJP leaders, including Shivraj Singh Chauhan, who was named in that diary as the recipient of 10 crores. And there is a photograph which was published in the local newspaper showing Shivraj Singh Chauhan at the residence of Justice Arun Mishra in Gwalior at his nephew's wedding. Now, this being the case, and he dismisses all of these, that CVC challenge he dismisses on the basis of some documents handed over to him by the government in a sealed cover. And he says, yes, government has looked into all these charges, etc. Everything has been found to be okay. And on that basis, he dismisses the application. What happens in Calico Pool? In Calico Pool, as you've been told, a sitting chief minister, not a former chief minister of Arunachal, commits suicide at the site of the place where his body is found hanging. 10 copies of a 40-page suicide note, duly signed on in each copy, on each page of each copy by him, is found. The lieutenant governor of Arunachal writes, Mr. Rajeshwar, I think, writes to the governor, at Goa, writes to the central government saying that this suicide note contains very, very serious allegations of bribery of Supreme Court judges, senior Supreme Court judges, and various other people. And suicide note is like a dying declaration which is entitled to be treated with great seriousness. And therefore, please have this investigated. But nothing is done. No investigation. Ultimately, the wife of this Calico Pool approaches the Supreme Court, approaches the Chief Justice, because there is a judgment of the Supreme Court in Veera Swami's case that no investigation can be done against a judge without the prior permission of the Chief Justice. Now, by this time, One of the gentlemen who was named, there were two judges who were named as having taken a bribe or having asked for a bribe. One of them had become the Chief Justice. So this wife wrote a letter to the Chief Justice saying that, look, I am having to write to you because that judgment says that the permission of the Chief Justice should be obtained. However, you are yourself going to be the subject matter of this investigation, as is your successor. Therefore, please send it to the next judges in line for deciding whether an FIR and an investigation needs to be done in this case or not. And what this Chief Justice does is, instead of sending it to the next judges in seniority, he immediately lists it before court number 12. Court number 12, he straight away goes down the line through 11 judges, goes to the 12th judge and lists it before him. Why? Because that judge happens to be a gentleman who was a very, very close personal friend and who had spent his entire life in the same court, that is the Punjab and Haryana High Court, and who was a very close personal friend of that Chief Justice. That's when Mr. Dushyant Dave, who was appearing in the matter, seeks to withdraw that application. So, what these cases, it's a brilliant job that has been done. It's a document of record, which will be a reference book and a document of reference for all scholars, all researchers, all journalists in the time to come about these cases. It's a very, very thoroughly documented book. And what it shows, among the other lessons to be learned from all this, is firstly that this business of political funding, you see, all that Birla Sahara was showing was that 25 crores and 40 crores and 10 crores cash, all cash had been given to these people. We have been saying today most political parties are showing that 90% of the donations received by them is in the form of cash. We have been saying for a long time, Mr. Modi says that I did demonetization in order to make a cashless society where ordinary people transact their entire business through banks, banking channels, etc. I've been saying that, well, forget ordinary people, but at least political parties and candidates should be made to go cashless. You must have a law which says that all donations, all expenditure by political parties and candidates should only be through banking channels. But that has not been done. In fact, the opposite has been done, where you have not only freed political parties to receive foreign funding by amending the FCRA, but you have also introduced this non-transparent instrument called electoral bonds, by which you can anonymously donate, even through banking channels, you can anonymously donate to political parties. The second thing that lesson that it shows is that there is a lacuna in that Veera Swami judgment. It doesn't deal with what should be done, doesn't effectively deal with what should be done if the allegation is against the Chief Justice. It should have said that it will go to the next judge in seniority. Unfortunately, it says that then the president can consult such other judges and decide. We had sent a complaint to the vice president also, because the note contained allegations against the then sitting president, Mr. Pranab Mukherjee, as well. So therefore, we had sent the complaint to the vice president. But unfortunately, he also didn't do anything about it. Thirdly, this clearly shows the need for having a judicial complaints authority on the lines of the Lokpal. You need to have a judicial Lokpal. Of course, even this Lokpal has not been appointed, but what we have been saying for a very long time is that this impeachment system is totally bogus. It's not practical, not workable. Instead of that, you need to have a full-time judicial complaints authority to deal with complaints against judges. Third is this whole business of master of roster, that the Chief Justice, being the master of roster, he can arbitrarily assign any case to anybody that he wants. We have seen this problem happening in all these cases. Even this Birla Sahara case was sent to judge number 10. Justice Arun Mishra. And one last thing, you see, there are various ways of influencing judges. One of them is post lure of post-retirement jobs. But this government has invented a totally novel way, which is to blackmail them by getting some evidence collected against them through the enforcement agencies like CBI, etc., CBI Enforcement Directorate, etc. This government has specialized in blackmailing opposition leaders, various other persons, including, unfortunately, judges as well, by collecting information against them through the CBI, etc. So, these are some of the lessons to be learned from all this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prashant.
This is a very important book, and the two stories it tells are two very different stories, actually. They're both stories of corruption, but they're two very different stories. The first story is one of alleged bribery by big companies, by the Birla and Sahara group, of various political masters. But let us be clear, very often, you know, we speak today of the BJP because the BJP is in power. But this is very much a document that implicates both of the biggest parties. And I think this is very important to remember. The reason I think that this is very important is because the issue that it speaks to is an issue that is in almost the design of our liberal democracy. Because our liberal democracy is silent on this issue. When we speak of individual rights, when we speak of, you know, even in our constitution, this great document, which, you know, if I identify with any document, it's that. I identify as a constitutionalist more than not an activist, but a constitutionalist more than anything else. When you speak of individual rights and you are silent on structural issues, and whether or not you're a Marxist, and I'm not, the Marxist critique of liberalism, I think, is the substance that gives rise to the kind of nexus that affects not only the environment, that affects the daily lives of small people, and that affects the everyday governance of whichever viable party that you choose to elect. The reason that they are viable is because of this money itself. When you see pictures of a candidate on the top, on the front page of every single newspaper, not because that headline has been earned for any reason, but because it has been paid for, then you have to wonder where that money is coming from. This document is a document that also speaks at a time when it is absolutely vital to speak. The reason that it is vital is because it is a document that shows how our institutions have failed us spectacularly. First, the CBI, for example, in the documentation of the Birla case, the CBI performs the rate the CBI pays to prosecute. For some reason, and perhaps it will become clearer, the Income Tax Department does do its job and does proceed further. However, when this comes up at the highest levels, it gets knocked out. My interest is very much, yes, of course, in this case, but in the structure of democracy that we need to look at and we need to examine, and that the only thing left, if the only thing left, is for writers and journalists to document this and to put to the people. What is it that the people must ask for? What is it that we must ask for? I think that in the run-up to the 2019 election, and not just that, in the state elections as well, I think one of the most important things to ask for, something that goes to the heart of all of these, or many of these problems, not all of these problems, but many of these problems, is electoral finance. We saw the obtaining of money legally by the top two parties through the amendments of the foreign exchange, FCRA, the Foreign Contributions Act. And there was a complete, it was passed without much of a debate, really, and it was passed almost without being noticed. And that is legal campaign finance. So this is now foreign companies can donate to a very significant extent legally to the largest political parties. This is a document of the illegal donation. What is the solution? We just don't talk about it enough. Some countries which have clean systems much, much cleaner than ours speak of partial campaign finance given by the state. So partial electoral finance given by the state. And there are reasons that they don't give complete electoral finance because the sort of competition reduces and too many people stand. This, I think, is a debate that we really, really need to start having. And I think the second thing is that when four judges came out and spoke in the Judge Loya case, those problems have not been completely addressed. Again, it's a structural problem. This is not to impugn any particular judge at all. But again, this is a structural problem. You know, the old adage that justice must not only be done but must seem to be done is something that we don't even say today. And why don't we even say it? Because now there is a shamelessness in governance and there is a shamelessness at democracy that is so deeply saddening that I think that reconstructing our institutions with structures that do not fail, and if the structures fail, people like Paranjoy and Sourya, and Sourya, you've done a really great job, I must congratulate you, and of course Paranjoy, and the courage that you show is vital. I also want to say as a last comment that the reason that people don't write these books is because the law of criminal defamation, for example, was upheld. It's a law that I and many others have challenged in the Supreme Court, and there is a whole story of bench allocation in our case. We were not before Justice Patricia, which I will not go into the present time. But the law of criminal defamation still exists and needs to be referred vitally to a 9-judge bench. The last book of Paranjoy that I was on a panel on, that he had written about, was on strategic lawsuits against public participation, where corporate groups sue journalists and writers like this for hundreds and hundreds of crores. And, you know, Hartosh, I'm sure, knows all about. And that is another sort of stick, that's another stick that must be limited and must be regulated. Because then, when our institutions fail, we certainly don't want even these people to be silent. They've taken the very important step, and they're questionnaires at the back, of putting the allegations that they have made here, and the allegations are founded on, basically they are asking for an investigation. They are saying that there are a number of papers here, they reach a particular standard, so an investigation should be made. And this is something that is squarely covered under the Reynolds defense. The Reynolds defense is one of the standards in English law, which has been brought into our law in the wonderful judgment of NSC versus Money Life, where Money Life that asked sort of very strong but pointed questions to the National Stock Exchange was, in a defamation suit by the Stock Exchange, was given 50 lakhs. Money Life was given 50 lakhs for the trouble that they went through. A lot of the upholding of democracy happens because citizens speak and citizens ask questions. And these, I think, questions, and this is a point where questions, protests, speaking, looking for answers is extremely important. Thanks.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Soumya and Paranjoy have produced fascinating work of investigative journalism. It's a complex book. The narrative runs at several levels, and divides into many strands, going back and forth in time. But in the process, they weave an intricate tapestry which depicts a dystopian image of an ecosystem in which you see the organs of the various organs of the state and big business in an illicit relationship. All the organs are compromised. The book raises some difficult questions to which there are no easy answers. But the very act of formulating those questions is a meritorious act, because that constitutes the first step in a collective quest for solutions. Prashant and Dinesh Trivedi have dwelt at length on the legal issues involved. Prashant has also brought out all the important facts which are covered by this book, so I'll not dwell on them. But it leaves this narrative leaves two questions uppermost in the mind of the reader. The first question is the state of sometimes the state of the Indian polity. Why do we have the kind of phenomena that has been documented in this book? Huge stashes of cash tumbling out of cupboards kept in the corporate offices, transactions involving hundreds of crores recorded in meticulous detail in a spreadsheet with all the particulars of the recipient and the deliverers of cash, date, time, and everything. That it has been hinted at the insatiable cash need of the political system is what is driving this phenomenon. And the cases covered in this book presented a rare opportunity of setting things right and cleansing the Indian polity of this scourge of political corruption. But it was an opportunity that was missed. This also has been dealt with at length, so I'll not go into those details. But for our part, I'm speaking on behalf of Common Cause. We are doing what we can. We have challenged the varieties of the amendments that have been made to through the Finance Act, to the People's Representation Act, to FCRA, and all the statutory framework that governs political contribution, along with ADR, that matter has been agitated in the Supreme Court and is under the consideration of the court. But one is not very sure, one is not very hopeful of the outcome going by the trend of the recent judgment. Again, there has been a suggestion that the present dispensation has found a very effective device of taming the apex court. A lot of hopes have been pinned on the current Chief Justice, particularly after the rebellious act of holding the press conference in January this year. But then it should also be remembered that the deportment changes after one accedes to an office. So while outside the office one can take a certain position, but the responsibilities of office have a very sobering effect on the rebellious traits that one might display while not holding that office. So we are keeping our fingers crossed, and we are not particularly hopeful of the outcome, but then this is all that one could have done. The other question is about the role of the institutions of governance. Now, the one lever that the executive has, the most significant lever, is the unfettered power of appointment and nomination to the institutions of governance. This is an area where Common Cause has been making valiant efforts to change the rules of the game, to have the rules of the game changed. But then these efforts have not been successful. We started with the institution of the Comptroller and the Auditor General of India from the times of Mr. K.G. Shawri. And then we followed it up again when an opportunity presented itself. This time because we were barred by res judicata to Public Cause Research Foundation. And then third time as individuals, a group of public spirited individuals, including myself, we joined hands and filed a petition in the Supreme Court challenging the arbitrariness inherent in the appointment of the CNAG, but the outcome has been consistent, and every time the Supreme Court on a very, very technical issue has thrown out the petition, because the interpretation that the position that the Supreme Court has adopted is a literalist position. They say that the Constitution does not have any provision for laying down any qualifications for this CNAG, for laying down the procedure of appointment, and the executive decision is an untrammeled one, and they can do whatever they like. That is to some substance of the verdict of the Supreme Court. Now, we have seen over time that the executive displays a marked preference for compromised candidates, because obviously such candidates are expected to be beholden to the powers that be for the favors shown by giving them an undeserved appointment. And then secondly, the dossiers that the government has on their past shenanigans also makes them very pliable and makes them show the official line because of the threat of initiating action for the past. So in this manner, the institutions of governance are undermined systematically, and that's been happening with absolute brazenness. There was a reference to the challenge that was made to the appointment of the CDC. Now, you look at the irony. The CDC is the agency that exercises the superintendence over the CBI, which is the principal investigating agency in matters of corruption. And the CBC is an integrity institution. There was a lot of enthusiasm and optimism generated by the judgment of the Supreme Court in the case of P.J. Thomas, whose appointment as the CBC was challenged by CPIL and Common Cause. Yeah. Whose appointment as CBC was challenged by CPIL and Common Cause, a new jurisprudence of integrity of institutions was laid down. But that judgment, like many other judgments, has remained a dead letter. Because what has followed that? you have seen that in the case of K.V. Chaudhary and Bhatin, whose appointment as Vigilance Commissioner, CPIL and Common Cause has challenged. There was a very, very serious allegation against Chaudhary. There were serious allegations against documented evidence against Mr. Bhatin, but the Supreme Court chose not to interfere with the appointment, and they were upheld. And you see the role that was played by the CBC in the CBI matter, which has come to boil recently. You see the role that was played by the CBC in the Sahara Birla diaries. So this has been happening. So institutions are being systematically undermined everywhere. We have seen this nexus between the political executive, big business, the top echelons of bureaucracy getting thicker and thicker. We have seen institutions being hollowed out of their substance. So one doesn't know how to address the problem. The elections are around the corner. Held that the electorate can exercise an effective control over the course of events once in 5 years. So that time is coming around. I do not know how. I have no way of reading the tea leaves and predicting future. But let's see whether all this information, all this documented history of these cases, which has been covered in these books, is going to influence the outcome of the election. One can only hope. So I would again like to compliment the author for doing such a thorough job. They have adhered to the cold facts while presenting the story in a way which makes it stranger than fiction. But then it is, whatever has been stated in the book is absolute verity and nothing else. Thank you.
As everybody has said, this is a first-rate book, absolutely first-rate, and it is a great tribute to Sourya and to Paranjoy for having written this detailed thing. And by taking up to 3 cases, the Birla papers, the Sahara papers, and to pull the diary, pull the note, they have actually conclusively demonstrated this nexus between politicians, businessmen, I would say lawyers, judges, and by our silence on many of these issues, they have shown how we are also a part of the same nexus as we are journalists. And that this nexus is at every level, it is in every institution, it is in every region, it cuts across political parties, it cuts across professions. And in that sense, it is really this business of the biblical state, that when the salt of the earth has lost its saltness, with what shall things be salted? That is our problem today. That is why everybody is at a wit's end. If we have kiya kya jaye agar sare is kuwe mein hai. You see, the origin of this whole issue is that by the 1970s, it has become clear that this Indian socialism had just become Indian patronage, and people could grow in India only by access to the state. And the expectation was that if you freed the people, the hounds would run. There would be faster growth. Second, that there would be regulatory institutions which would be independent and which would keep the people within the
bounds of public interest. And the third was that there would be two classes which would keep, which would be always the propellers of reform, because they would be, their creativity would be inhibited by a frozen or a lifeless state. And these were the entrepreneurs and the middle class. And as this book shows, and as our experience every day shows, that actually speaking, even today, the entrepreneurs remain in the same mold, that you grow by access to persons in the state. The only exception in the last few years, in the last 2.5 decades, has been the IT sector. As this one knows, that because the state did not notice them, they grew on their own. But otherwise, if you see any of these big business houses, and now the houses which are becoming big, like Ramdev, like this Ravi Shankar, Adani, all these persons are again because of their access to the state that they are able to grow very fast. And it is in that sense that the book documents so well that the hope of that the premises underlying reform have turned out to be wrong. Those are premises of persons like me. So the issue, there is a serious issue, and these loose pages is a very fine way to attract our attention to that. You see, even in a bound diary or a bound book, I can use codes. So that if I am taking the money, Mr. Dwivedi is paying the money to Arun Shori, but he always uses the name of Jaiswal. And therefore, and that code of Jaiswal means Arun Shori is actually kept in some safe in Bahamas. So when the documents are discovered, you all say Jaiswal has taken the money, but actually it is Arun Shori who has taken the money. So it was for this reason that in the Jainwala case, Karuna will correct me if I am wrong, and the senior advocate will correct me, that it was said that yes, they are evidence, but you must, but they are the reasons for further investigation. Now in these cases, as Prashant explained to us, that actually speaking, they were not just sort of vague entries. These were entries which were detailed. Who gave the money, on what date, where, through whom, and so on. And they match other documents of that particular company. And in the case of Pull, again, it was a dying declaration. Therefore, it is a very specific thing that in such and such contract, in such and such irrigation work, in procuring such and such judgment, so much money was paid. Now, here was prima facie, you could see, the court could have said, yes, we would like to see whether, let us take 10 random cases, 5 random cases, and see if the facts are borne out. The allegations here are borne out by evidence. But they chose not to do so at all, in contravention of their many previous judgments. And the second thing that comes through in this Sourya and Paranjoy's book is how easily these things are brushed aside. You see, these the cash which is recovered. How do they say, the entries which are there, they are detailed entries. So the person says, sir, nahi, this is the entry of, these are fabricated papers. Means produced by one employee, disgruntled employee, so as to defame his boss. And everybody seems to accept that, the court seems to accept that. Similarly, the cash, nahin, ye hamari nahin, ye iski private cash hai. Ye private cash khud apne investment ke liye use kar raha tha. 25 crore, 137 crore. How can it be? But the court found it interesting. Then, you just transfer the income tax officer is just transferred. Now just see the same thing happened in the case of Rafael. In the price negotiating committee, they increased the benchmark price by 40% or 50%, I guess. And three officers objected. And one officer wrote a detailed note on this. And what did they do? They just asked the officer to go on leave. And the person who was a strict officer was just made the secretary of the UPSC and was replaced by another person who facilitated the transition, course of this note of raising the price without any justification. And she became the youngest member of the UPSC. So you just do this. मगर उसमें मुश्किल ये भी है कि हम लोग एंड द बुक ऑल्सो ब्रिंग्स आउट अक्रॉस प्रोफेशन इट इज नॉट जस्ट द सिविल सर्वेंट बट द रोल ऑफ लॉयर्स इन ऑल देयर इज नॉट बीन अ स्कैंडल इन इंडिया व्हिच हैज नॉट बीन फैसिलिटेटेड बाय द चार्टर्ड अकाउंटेंट एंड बाय दिस वेरी बिग कंपनीज प्राइस वाटर हाउस एंड सो ऑन सत्यम डिप्टी ऑडिटर Okay, all these fellows books are being audited regularly. And there is not a big criminal who has not been able to get a big lawyer or to silence a big journalist. So this is across professions in this May. And unfortunately, it extends up to the judges. They are not, after all, people from heaven. They are from among us. And they accept patently false pleas. Of all these characters. And they do not use the power that they have, for instance, on perjury. Whether in the Sohrabuddin murder case, I think it's probably now by now, 53 or some people have resigned. Similarly, the obvious evidence in the case of, how many people have died on natural death, but they don't look at it. So the judges become a part of this whole problem. And I will just say one small thing about the features that come out and then suggest as to what is the one sovereign remedy that we have. And that is, one is the cascading effect of all this. The Quranic Ahavat hai, Faraz has been reminded us, if tariq sikhati hai, ki lamho ne khata ki aur sadiyo ne saza pai. Aap ek chuti sati karte ho, CDC ka example diya gaya, His application is well known in the enforcement directory. And you make him the CDC, and in the next round, he is the judge. Today, he is the judge on Alok Verma. In effect. So the cancer cells are spread by the doctors themselves by being put from one body into a higher body. And unfortunately, the most in all this, the inner democracy. The only counterweight could have been the media. But unfortunately, we have become a part of the same establishment. And it is not just that we can't go on blaming that, yes, now big business has entered the media, therefore we don't have freedom. But it is that Marxist phrase that they appear as giants because we are on our knees. That is our problem. We do not use Just as the judges do not use the power of contempt, against perjury to curb it, we in journalism do not use the power that we can still use. I don't think any owner would have stopped us from analyzing the defense budget in detail. But you show me the last analysis in the mainline papers, other than Ajay Shukla and others. A few persons who do just an analysis of the defense budget. We just don't do it. So, and that is why, that's my final point, the delusion that we suffer from, that one person will save us from another person, that Mrs. Gandhi, Sanjay Gandhi ko rokegi, Narendra Modi, Amit Shah ko rokega, Rajnath Singh, which are a Majboor Rajput, वो नरेंद्र मोदी को रोकेगा कि सुषमा क्या कर रही है या कि वन इंस्टीट्यूशन विल सेव अस फ्रॉम ए डिक्टेटोरियल टेंडेंसीज ऑफ अ रूलर But the fact of the matter is that that institution has been subjected to the same processes of rot, which have enabled or which have facilitated or propelled the dictatorial ruler to acquire those powers at the top. This is our problem. And that is why I find that the solution always in such matters has to come from outside. It has to come from individuals. And it has to come from, if I may use an old phrase, I have written about it almost 30 years ago, about from marginal men. Hartosh is here. When Mr. K.P.S. Gill was made in charge of the Punjab police, the fact is that there was no Punjab police. It had evaporated. He started the fight as an individual by mobilizing individuals. And then a force came up. There was no judiciary. In the same way, this fight against the way that things have become now has to come from individuals, and it can only come from the marginal individual. Because if you are very big in this particular system, then naturally you are a part of that system. That's why you are big in the particular system. And Paranjoy's work, Sourya's work, the work of Prashant Bhushan, the work of Common Cause, this shows that actually speaking, one individual, a small man, can make a difference. That is the great hope that we have to rest on, and even if it doesn't come true, there is never any success or failure in this matter. I'll give you one example and then just come to two precautions which I think we should, the marginal men should take. The example is of what Gandhiji said in Champaran. You see, he, as you remember, the condition of indigo cultivators had become very poor and there was a satyagraha, and he would always pitch his demand at the minimum. His demand was, set up a committee, please set up a committee to examine the condition of the indigo cultivators. Now just see, there is no failure in that. Why? Because if the British government sets up a committee, then you have bent the British Empire, the poor peasants have bent the British Empire. And if it does not set up the committee, then your point is proven. Ki are bhai, wo committee bhi nahi banayenge, to tum unko kya mai baat samajhte ho? Similarly, if books like Sourya and Paranjoy's book have an effect, wonderful. If they don't have an effect, they hold a mirror to us about the stage to which our country has reached. That itself is a very great service. So I think it has to come from marginal men, and it will succeed. There is no success or failure in their efforts. But I would suggest two very small suggestions. There are two prerequisites for this kind of work. One is that one must be absolutely truthful. Because if we, even by error, make a small mistake, or if we twist even one fact, the chaps who are inconvenienced by our disclosures will latch on to that fact and destroy our entire credibility. And the second is that we should all be a little humble. Because one thing that happens when you take up such work is that you start feeling, are sare sare wo chor hai, sirf main honest hu. That is not the case. And I am very glad that in this particular book, I say this because I come in for some politely marginal, censure at one point myself in the particular book. So I say this, that it is a wonderful thing that in this book, Sourya and Paranjoy have stuck to the facts. Every single paragraph has been well documented. It is based on the documents that nobody can deny. And therefore, they have done a great service to journalism and to all of us. Thank you very, very much. Thank you.